Hello students, welcome to EPG Pathshala. I am Dr. Anupama, professor at Department of Economics, Punjabi University, Patiala. I am here talking on behalf of Dr. Phalendra Kumar Sudhan, professor, Department of Economics, University of Jammu. I am going to talk about the module Women and Climate Change from Demography of Climate Change Adaptation. So students, we are going to discuss about the effects of climate change on women and their responses to climate change. Women are disproportionately affected by climate change impacts. Women have been adapting to climate change long before scientists named it or policymakers started to draft a response. Women are primarily responsible for feeding their families, raising and educating children, and caring for their communities against all odds. Their innovations often remained helpful in improving the well-being of the wider population. It is always demonstrated by women and women's organizations that there exists a great possibility of change. For effective planning and activity implementation, balanced participation of women and men as relevant stakeholders is required. Projects and programs can be strengthened by incorporating and investing in women's capacity as change agents, innovators, educators, leaders, and caretakers. Together with scientific data, existing information in the form of local and indigenous knowledge is also necessary. No human being is carbon neutral, especially when all greenhouse gases are taken. Since everyone is a part of problem, so everyone must be a part of solution as well. Government and people should work together to tackle the problem. One problem is growing population. As per the United Nations Population Division's low population growth scenario, world population would be about 8 billion by 2050. It will lead to 1 or 2 billion tons of less carbon than the population with medium growth scenario of a little above 9 billion. So, this module aims to explore the effects of climate change on women and their responses to climate change and to draw the policy implications for greater involvement of women in climate mitigation and adaptation efforts. The reduced population growth coupled with high income growth offset high emission associated with faster economic growth. By 2020, family planning effect on carbon emission would be 15% lower for developing countries than without family planning. Strong family planning is needed for reducing greenhouse emission and improving welfare. Investment in women and girl, child to improve their health and well-being will lead to reduction in fertility rates and thus reduce greenhouse gas emission in long run. Opportunities are there to reduce emissions and take carbon out of atmosphere effectively by considering gender differences. As per the estimates of FAO, women produce half of the food of the world and about 60% to 80% in developing countries. Capacity of forest soil to absorb carbon, that is carbon sequestration is creating interest to keep emissions low. If financial instruments are devised so as to encourage such activities, climate change could become more damaging. The women farmers can be at forefront of mitigation policies. This could affect women's livelihood by allowing women to own the land they cultivate and earn the income. World is already witnessing the power of women, so she can also contribute in lowering carbon dioxide. Wangari Maathai won the Nobel Peace Prize for mobilizing women to plant thousands of trees in deforested and degraded areas of Kenya. In India, Chipko movement drew women to protect forest and their own forestry rights by linking arms and hands around trees so that they are not cut. This movement brings reforms in Indian forestry and resulted in increase in forest cover today. Women, men, and greenhouse gas emissions. If greenhouse gas emissions start with human activities, will men and women have different shares? Women in developed countries are sustainable consumers, that is, they buy goods which are environmental friendly, are more likely to recycle, and are energy efficient. Women in developed countries account for 80% of consumer decision. It is still not clear that consumption pattern which is environmental friendly is the result of women consciousness or economic and social inequalities that prevent women from contributing to country's development. In USA, women buy more green products than men. Women also trust less on government's ability to solve environmental problems and want to take action personally. These gender differences are more in high-income people. Women are more concerned by environmental problems. Men and boys are less concerned and more drawn toward technology and governance in discussing climate-related issues. Women are having less impact on environment as they travel less, be it cars or airplanes. The difference is not due to attitude regarding environment, but unequal access to economic resources and less decision-making power. Another difference is related to greenhouse-related consumption. In developed countries, men eat more meat. In Denmark, men eat 139 grams of meat every day compared to 81 grams eaten by Danish women. Reproductive health, population, and the Millennium Development Goals. Each MDG has human component and it needs to be addressed to resolve them. These goals cannot be achieved if population and reproductive health are not addressed. This calls for stronger effort to promote women's rights and greater investment in education and health, including reproductive health and family planning. The voluntary family planning decreases child mortality, that is MDG4, and improves maternal health, that is MDG5. Slow population growth helps in eradication of hunger, or MDG1, and improves school enrollment and quality of education, that is MDG2. Preventing sexually transmitted diseases prevent transmission of HIV, while family planning help HIV positive women to decide for themselves and about childbirth, hence reducing the transmission from mother to the child, that is MDG6. Ensuring environmental sustainability can help in reducing water shortage, loss of forest, loss in biodiversity, and many other problems. Adaptation imperative. Some counterbalancing forces are needed to tackle climate change. Otherwise, temperatures is likely to increase for decades. The world should get ready for warmer world, although the intensity can't be explained and any scientists can't assure that the particular weather event is because of anthropogenic climate change. The central range of likely temperature increases in the coming century can be 2 degrees or 4.5 degrees Celsius, which is a matter of concern. The low elevation coastal zones are less than 10 meters above sea level. These are home to 13% of the world's urban population. Among the world's large cities at risk are Dhaka, Jakarta, Mumbai, New York, Shanghai, and Tokyo. Considering the setbacks to health and development, the governments need to do some urgent steps so as to help civilization to withstand such events. We have just started to think about human impacts on climate change, as explained by IPCC. One message, however, emerges from history and recent experience. When conditions are harsh and resources scarce, the poor and groups marginalized by more than poverty, women, the young, the elderly, indigenous people, and other minorities are the most vulnerable. Integrating MDGs with climate change concerns will improve reproductive health and help in achieving gender equality. Let us examine social and cultural aspects of vulnerability and adaptation. The discrimination against gender hampers development process, health, and overall well-being of humans in countries resilient to climate change. Resilience will bloom if all people can go to school, access health services, enjoy equality of law, and participate fully in directing their own lives and the destinies of their communities and nations. Being less in numbers and because of gender inequality, women are most disadvantageous in coping and surviving from the shocks. Food insecurity, water scarcity, and conflicts would increase as the planet heats more. Women represent half of the world's population and constitute major proportion of poor population. In many societies, women get less paid for same work as that done by any male. Also, they sometimes get married to a low-income person who then uses her money to his personal expenditure like alcohol, drugs, and gambling. Single parents' households are headed by women, and most of them are very poor. The impact of high poverty rate among women and social expectation about their behavior are obvious in the recent history of the onset and aftermath of natural disasters. Women die more than men in natural disasters, although there is not enough reliable data to support it. In disastrous 1992 flood in the Sargodha district of Pakistan, women helped in making designs of new houses for their families and became joint owners of the homes. After a 1999 cyclone in Odisha, India's most relief efforts were directed through women who received relief supplies, loans, and house building grants, which resulted in improvements in their social status. Disaster hygiene and sexual violence. In the year that followed the deadly tsunami of 2004, UNFPA distributed hundreds of thousands of personal hygiene kits containing, in addition to such basic items such as soap, toilet paper, toothbrushes, and sanitary napkins, condoms for prevention of HIV and other sexually transmitted infection, as well as unwanted pregnancy. Other equipment supplied in post-tsunami includes emergency contraception, safe delivery materials, and drugs for the treatment of sexually transmitted diseases. Over the past decade,
UNFPA has developed an emergency response capacity to deliver essential reproductive health services to those recovering from disasters resulted in producing long-term benefits for affected populations. It can be said that with sufficient funding and commitment by political leaders, such interventions could become universal rather than targeted, helping population around the world to reduce vulnerability to climate change.
Now let us discuss about climate change and conflict. Climate change will add to the factors already causing violent civil conflicts in weaker states around the world. Such states constitute 9% of the world population, but more than half of the world's poor. Increasing the likelihood of gender discrimination and inadequate reproductive health. There has been environmental deterioration and civil conflict besides scarcity of water and fertile land. The conflict in the Darfur region of Sudan may be one example of violence worsened by the impacts of climate change. With declining rainfall, the climate change was intensifying desertification and leading to tension in the region. The women of the Darfur have paid a high price for the violence in the form of rape and other forms of sexual violence, high water scarcity, and fuel wood shortages in the resource-poor region.
HIV/AIDS and climate change. The future of HIV and AIDS will depend on society's capacity to adapt not only to infectious diseases, but also to shortage of food and water, storms, and other climate-related impacts. The success of HIV prevention and AIDS treatment can help in building resilience against most diverse threats of climate change. The main area of concern includes food security, distribution of infectious diseases, and poverty. One more concern was that climate change could reduce income from natural resource incentive activities like farming and fishing, thereby driving women into sex work and thus increasing infection from HIV. Insecurity of food. It is the agriculture sector to which well-being of women is connected. Women produce more food of the world. Women don't get the land they cultivate. According to International Center for Research on Women, less than 15% of land is owned by women. The world is learning how precarious food security can be, even when the impacts of climate change are visible. The main impact of climate change on agriculture is replacement of food crops by crops like sugarcane, sweet corn, etc. With increase in population, food production has increased and agribusiness is replacing farmers, particularly women. This problem is more in developing countries where farmers are investing in cash crops rather than subsistence crops. Farmers are also facing competition from urban people for the limited fresh water. Change in precipitation has put stress on food supply around the globe. Therefore, it is difficult to predict threats from climate change. To get rid of excess carbon dioxide, people will have to turn to farmers. The farmers will need to change them from net emitters to net absorbers of greenhouse gases to prevent the increase in concentration. This can be done by changing agricultural production system based on carbon content and also reduce use of chemical fertilizers.
Now it is interesting to know how indigenous women adapt to climate change. Indigenous people especially indigenous women, have not enough representation in the global talks regarding climate change, but they can make vital contribution. Many of the solutions that are being discussed now have always been a way of life for our ancestors and present generations. Climate change issue is a social justice issue. Reducing greenhouse gases is half of the battle, and the other half, often neglected, is promoting sustainable development. Indigenous women also play an important role in adaptation by developing flood and drought resistant crops and also protecting water resources. Indigenous women are affected by climate change in different ways than men. It is important to understand those differential impacts to solve the problems of women. They need appropriate family planning services. The reproductive health care is crucial for women. The population growth is a major cause of climate change. Women have to be ones to decide how many children they have.
Now let us discuss about some policy implications. Women are very concrete and pragmatic to move quickly to solutions. Women's practical nature and her farsightedness are very much needed to reduce impact of climate change. Women in developing countries are more close to nature, which may help in fighting climate challenge. The best way to tackle environmental problem is to improve the lives of the girls and women. For example, an investment in public transportation is necessary, not only to decrease emission from vehicles, but also to connect women to educational, commercial, and political opportunities. Similarly, introduction of photovoltaics in areas which do not have grids can free women time and connect them to outside world. Women can contribute much in solving the problem of climate change and other environmental issues. Women must be empowered. Until 2004, 75% of greenhouse gases were emitted by developed countries, which contain only 20% of world's population, whereas 80% population living in developing countries, which emits only 25% of total greenhouse gases. Therefore, there is a need to reduce consumption and change the lifestyles that are unsustainable. Women in developed countries have power to reduce carbon footprints of their families and also reduce environmental impacts on their families. In developing countries, women have power to reject any consumption pattern and make a new alternative pattern. The second one is related with cooperating to engage women. The Canadian International Development Agency is working with the government of China to reduce carbon emissions in China's paper and pulp, fertilizer and plastic industries, but with a gender twist to the work. The Canada-China Cooperation Project in Cleaner Production aims for at least 30% participation of women in the project and to greatly expand their representation among managers, technicians, and workers in the industries. Various gender equality awareness sessions are designed so as to develop gender analysis into various activities of the project. Women receive trainings, auditing practices, monitoring equipments, and computer use so that overall improvement can occur in women. The main motive behind this is to increase women abilities, awareness, and self-confidence so as to address climate change issues. Women farmers tackling climate change. Thousands of women in the interior of Andhra Pradesh are now offering chemical-free, non-irrigated organic agriculture as one method of combating global warming. Indian agriculture accounts for 28% emission of greenhouse gases, mostly in the form of methane in paddy fields and nitrous oxide from fertilizers. The pattern of rainfall will change in India, with heavy rainfall only for a few days, thus creating confusion in agriculture scenarios. Less rain in December, January and February implies less storage of water, which will create water stress in summer and in extreme cases may lead to droughts. In India, a 0.5 degree rise in temperature would reduce wheat production by 0.45 tons per hectare. Women and resilience. The elements that make society resilient to climate change are the one that lead to equitable development, full human rights, social and environmental justice, and sustainable environment. Women have limited access to contribute to society's development. Without proper social support, the reproductive and family role limits women participation in economic and political life. Heavy domestic work made impossible for them to work outside the home. In rural sub-Saharan Africa, women typically spend 2 to 6 hours per week carrying water from a source within 400 meters of their household. Under such circumstances, economic and social opportunities available to women are mostly limited. On top of all these, gender disparities put limit on potential of women to pursue and achieve. Despite all the constraints, women are moving forward. They are finding new ways and methods so that they can make some impact on society, not just in terms of climate, but also sustainable social relation and sustainable environment.
Mobilizing for change. Working with farming communities along the flood-ravaged coast of southwestern Bangladesh, the humanitarian organization CARE has employed maximum women trained staff in gender relations and prioritized work with female-headed households. Earlier, women farmers used to cry over the fact that chickens, a profitable source of livelihood, were drowning when the monsoon season drove floodwaters over the land. The farmers and the non-governmental organizations identified a strategy that effectively solved this problem. Give up chickens, raise ducks. This strategy could serve adjusting to and thriving amidst the changes on the way. For the successful implementation of the task, it is necessary to mobilize the political will and public opinion for mitigation and adaptation to climate change. Women in both developing countries and the developed countries were working on climate change, either at global level or in their local communities. Men also join hands with women in strengthening this work. Those who work on climate change and those who work on reproductive health and rights have much in common and much to learn from each other.
The front lines of climate change. Women worldwide tend to manage energy at the household level, whereas men do it at national level. In the early 90s, solar cookers failed to catch on in Zimbabwe because men did not know anything about it and they objected the use of this device by women. Therefore, men use their power as the head of the household and refuse to buy the heaters. The main initiative behind opening of global microfinance schemes for the women is the fact that women are more likely than men to repay the loans taken for small-scale entrepreneurial activities. The microfinance idea began in Bangladesh with the Grameen Bank and is now an important part of lending at the World Bank and other multilateral finance institutions. In India, an organization called the Self-Employed Women's Association or SEWA has 5 lakh members in Western Gujarat state alone. Its bank boasts 3,50,000 depositors, and the repayment rate for its loans has been as high as 97%. During last few years, many evidences have shown the practical benefits of involving women in decision making at all levels. All these have helped them attending to the problems resulting from climate change directly or indirectly. Women and management of risk. The approach of men and women to financial and other risks is different. Men accept high risks so as to get larger gains, whereas women tend to avoid extreme risks. A study in France, for example, concluded that companies that most successfully weathered the 2008 global financial crisis were those with the highest proportion of women in management. During the past few years, there has been a rise in women enterprise, both in developed and developing countries, which has mainly grown to tackle the problem of climate change. Women farmers in Malawi are joining together in farmers' clubs to share the latest information about seeds and cultivation techniques that can take advantage of poor soils and irregular rainfall. In Bangladesh, some of the poor and marginalized women living along rivers have built temporary dwellings and harvest resources on chars. Being most vulnerable to the climate challenges, these women demonstrate the use of traditional knowledge to tackle the problem of climate change with no support from society. Women in Nepal are a step ahead as they are using video technology to communicate various adaptation strategies so as to make a difference.
So students, let us sum up what we have learned from this module. To sum up, we can say that it is not enough to just talk about more involvement of women, as government needs to remove various obstacles to women's participation in debates related to climate change. Gender equality will become a reality if government changes law and societies and the norms that isolate women from men. Although in legislative bodies, women can have at least 40% participation, and in future, this will be done, but facilities like education and health must support women so as to achieving the goal. The concept of human capital may lend itself to a greater understanding about the roots of overall development, of gender equality, and of the future of population growth. Women who complete 1 or 2 years of secondary school have an average of 1.9 children each, while those who complete 1 or 2 years of college have an average of just 1.7 children. Lower fertility decreases the growth rate of population, which in turn contributes to reducing of emissions and help in making effective adaptation techniques. Higher education increases women earning, improve their lifespan, reduce infant mortality, and keep them healthy during pregnancy and childbirth. Each of these benefits is a mark of societies that are likely to be resilient to climate change. Health is important for women, and it will affect women mobility to changes, since their reproductive role and caregiving and other domestic responsibilities are already creating burden on them. Reproductive health is especially catalytic for women. From difficult pregnancies and childbirths to HIV and other sexually transmitted infections, reproductive health problems comprise the leading causes of death and disability among women worldwide. That's all with this lecture. I hope you must have enjoyed it. Thank you.